Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of man, the God of miracles, the God of mercy.
Amen.
Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and lead us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved, in Jesus, the man from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life.
Amen.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Yes. excited and cheery and live. Walk in the way of insight. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
of this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood true drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died, but the one who eats this bread will live forever. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Martin Luther was a genius. Not only that, but one of the most influential thinkers who ever lived. I remember back at the Y2K transition from 1999 to 2000, and a lot of people were talking about who were the most influential people who lived in the last 1,000 years. Martin Luther consistently was among the top 10, often in the top 3, and on some lists listed number 1. His influence over Western civilization extended from theology to politics, government, philosophy, and social change of all kinds. However, at the same time, Martin Luther could be outrageous. At least by modern day sensibilities and norms of language. Some brief examples. We should take him, the Pope, the Cardinals, and whatever riffraff belongs to his idolatrous and papal holiness, blasphemers, tear off their tongues from the back, and nail them on the gallows. Why should we hesitate to use arms against those leaders of perdition, cardinals, popes, and the whole Roman sodom, which corrupts the Church of God without hand, and wash our hands in their blood? One more. How often must I cry out to you, coarse, stupid papists, to quote scripture sometime? Scripture, scripture, scripture! Do you not hear, you deaf goat and coarse ass? Now, these are my examples. I won't go into the other descriptions of bodily functions, etc. Many have tried to explain this tendency of Luther by saying the times were different, the norms of what was acceptable, language was different, he had a difficult life, etc., etc. But could it also be that the people to whom he was speaking were simply not understanding what he was saying? Was he exasperated and trying to get their attention? Was he frustrated about simply not getting through to his listeners? Now, the words that Jesus spoke in today's gospel lesson, even today, have the ability to kind of shock and sound jarring. Quite frankly, they can even sound extreme. But imagine how they sounded to his contemporary audience. Jews, who
Jewish law forbade the eating of blood of any kind, or even bloody meat. You know the kosher rules, the things that make meat kosher, have to do with the method that the animals are killed, but also the fact that then they are suspended and all the blood of the animal must drain out before the Jews are, Orthodox Jews are allowed to eat the meat. The idea then of eating human flesh was, of course, anathema to them. So to Jesus' audience, his words were not just shocking, they were outrageous. Why such rash language? Could it be that others were simply not understanding what he was saying? Was he exasperated and just trying to get through to his audience and get their attention? Let's look at the progression of Jesus' language and statements about the bread of life in chapter 6. It begins rather mildly. Verse 35, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Very soft, well understood words. Verse 50, one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread. Now we start to get a little stronger. Verse 51, the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. Finally, verse 57, whoever eats me will live. I get the picture of Jesus staring into the faces of fixed, blank stares. Jesus is exasperated. He simply was not getting through to them. Now, the last time I spoke to you, I mentioned that one of the chief messages of the Gospel of John is that Jesus is divine. He is the Word of God, made flesh and came to earth in flesh and blood. Not just a moral teacher or a prophet like Moses, but actually God on earth. I have two meditations to leave you with this morning. The first one is Jesus getting through to you? Who do you say that Jesus is? Are you understanding what he's saying? Now, I don't want you to answer like it was an answer on the catechism quiz, because we all know what the right answer is. Rather, I'm asking you the question to think deeper about Jesus in your own self. Who do you say that he is? Now, I could just leave you hanging there, because I have just accused us all of not having a perfect faith. This is what we call the law, and the law is good, and one of the things it does, it accuses us. We're not perfect, but where there is law, there should be gospel, especially in a Lutheran sermon. The law is good, but it cannot save. second meditation. Is there a time and place for us to be outrageous to? After all, we are taught to follow Jesus. I'm not talking about walking around in public places, beating your Bible, getting in people's faces. I think that kind of thing is most often counterproductive. But how about being an example of outrageous love? Take a chance on being outrageously kind, especially to someone whom you really don't like, who doesn't deserve it. How about taking a chance on outrageously forgetting? Sometimes I see a video on television of a courtroom where someone's been convicted of a horrible crime, and at the sentencing hearing, the family members get up to speak to the person who's been convicted. Sometimes they say awful things. They want revenge, want them to suffer. Once in a while, you see someone stand up and say, "You killed my daughter. I forgive you." Pretty outrageous. How about taking a chance on being outrageously caring? Homeless people, hungry people, dispossessed people, people who are emotionally or cognitively impaired and challenged. Outrageously generous. Outrageously inclusive. Sure, some of the actions of this congregation in being outrageously inclusive have been problematic for some. Outrageous love, the outrageous love of God, as you share it, you will feel it more and more all the time. Amen. the Spirit, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and the whole creation.
God of wisdom, enlighten your church. Guide theologians, biblical scholars, authors, and seminary professors as they seek greater knowledge and invite others into deeper understanding. Teach us to ask faithful questions and open our minds to new ideas. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of creation, mend the earth, cool warming oceans, and preserve melting ice caps. Increase our awareness of changing climate patterns and reveal new approaches to the ecological challenges we face. Shield those in the path of fires, hurricanes, or tropical storms. God, in your mercy. God of all nations, direct our leaders. Grant them courage to lay aside political grudges and renew their determination to address difficult conflicts. Guide them in the work of reconciliation. God, in your mercy. God of compassion, tend to the wounded. Rescue those tormented by mental illness or mired in addiction. Ease the anxiety of those struggling with dementia. Come quickly to help all those who are grieving and all those who suffer, especially Eric Van Maltenham, Ellen Copeland, Carol Colasano, Monica Johnson, Jeanette Todd. God, in your mercy. God of beauty, inspire artists. Bless those whose visual and musical gifts enlighten this assembly, especially Doris, Dave, Becky, all the choir. Bless the creative work of poets, hymn writers, composers, painters, sculptors, and others that enrich our worship and daily life. God, in your mercy. For whom or for what else do the people of God pray? I would like to offer prayers for those affected by COVID, which is, of course, all of us. I'd like to pray for the vaccinated and pray for those who are not vaccinated. I'd like to pray this morning for the people of Afghanistan. I'd like to offer an outrageous prayer for the Taliban, that they might be gifted with wisdom and mercy. God, in your mercy. God of resurrection, bring us to new life. Give us the living bread from heaven, through which we abide in your love. And on the last day, raise us with all the saints to eternal life. God, in your mercy. We lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now may the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
If you'd like to maybe turn and wave peace.
Hello, everyone. Hello, Strassman children again. Always good to see you guys.
You may be seated. This is the time when we would normally collect the offering, so I'd like to just remind you that there are offering plates as you leave the sanctuary today. And for you at home, encourage you to keep up with your pledges and offerings. It's a difficult time for all churches, and it's very important that we continue to support the work of this wonderful congregation.
When it comes time for communion, I'll just briefly review how we are conducting that. You had, when you came in, a choice between a wine and a wafer in a small kit, or grape juice and a wafer in another kit. Someone once asked Martin Luther when communion actually happened. Was it when the words of institution were read? When the prayer that the Holy Spirit descended on the bread and wine? Is that when it happened? He said that communion really happened when you hear the words given for you and you reach up and you take the element. So I suggest we all commune together today. When you hear the words for you and you see me take my wafer, then we can all commune together for both of the elements. Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, you have set this table with your very self and called us to the feast of plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us in this meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body for the life of the world.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord, our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You comforted your people with the promise of the Redeemer, through whom you will also make all things new in the day when he comes to judge the world in righteousness. And so with all the choirs of angels, the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Together as the body of Christ, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
With this bread and cup, we remember your Son, the firstborn of your new creation. We remember his life lived for others and his death and resurrection, which renews the face of the earth. We await his coming when, with the world made perfect through your wisdom, all our sins and sorrows will be no more.
Amen.
Come, Lord Jesus.
Holy God, holy and merciful.
Enfold in your arms all who share this holy food, nurturing in us the fruits of the Spirit, that we may be living trees, sharing your bounty with all the world.
Amen.
Now we pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For God is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Go in peace.